All right, so we're going to move on to a top 10. You ready for top 10?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else ready for top 10 out there? Yeah? Danny's in the cage. I was going to say Preston's there, but Danny's in the cage. Excellent. Guys, we believe two things are vitally important to your relationship with Jesus, and that is humor and humility. We believe the most holy people laugh, and laugh a lot, and usually at themselves. The psalmist says that God sits upon his throne and laughs. We think humor is very important. So we like to do a top 10, and so every week we throw up, or we put up. We don't really throw up, but we put up on our Facebook page, Waypoints Top 10. If you're not a follower, please do that. Our topic, and then all of you smart Alex, make your comments for the week.
Yeah.
And this topic you picked.
I picked.
Because you have a personal story with it.
Because I have a personal story. Yes. It's this one is comes from my
near and dear to your heart?
It's near and dear.
All right. Tell everybody what your top 10 is for tonight.
Tonight we got the top 10 signs your insurance company is crazy.
Yeah. Crazy. Nutso.
A joke.
Joke.
Never heard of an insurance company being weird. I mean.
Yeah. I laugh every time they send me a bill.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
So okay. These are all signs. Mine's in there. I'm not going to tell it. Just like, you'll have to guess. All right?
We have to guess which one of these is actually
real.
A true story in your life.
Yes. In my life, one of these is a true story.
Okay. I'm ready. I'm going to try to figure it out.
Is everybody else ready? Dan, are you ready?
Everybody
all right.
On his mic.
Number 10, sign your insurance company is crazy is... they have a line specifically exempting them from payouts due to bunny attacks. I mean...
What?
So if you get attacked by a bunny, they're not going to pay that claim.
This isn't Monty Python, dude. This isn't Holy Grail. This
He's
is,
got fangs!
It's got fangs! All right, okay.
And
all
he
right.
jumps this far, right? Number 9 sign.
In your general direction.
That your insurance company is crazy. They want me to pay how much for how little?
See, that is my insurance company.
that's mine.
That's my insurance company right there.
That's true.
That's a true one right there.
All
right.
Number
it's
eight
not funny.
Sign,
it's sad, actually, but that's okay.
That they are crazy. Their phone number is a 900 number. So you got to pay for that, and every time you call, it's...
What kind of insurance company do you have, man? That's...
Found him on vacation. I don't know.
That is awkward. All right, moving along. Okay.
Number 7 sign. You were denied coverage, but the good news is your dog is insured on your vehicle.
So that's good. So long as my dog has insurance, that's all that's really important.
Your dog can drive your
car.
All
right. Okay.
Totally cool.
Good.
Number 6 sign that they are crazy. They actually have a good plan that's really affordable.
That is nuts. That's
are they
going to
be around next year?
Probably not. They're too affordable. All right.
And the number 5 sign that your insurance company is crazy. They total your van and the claim check bounces. That one's true.
That
one's true.
That is true.
So I totaled my van like 3 months ago.
You actually didn't total it.
No, my mother-in-law did.
No. I was there. Somebody ran into your mother-in-law and totaled your van.
Yeah.
And then the other guy's insurance check bounced.
Bounced.
That's not good.
It skipped and I don't know.
The bank teller went...
Yeah, that's right.
No.
They're like,
all
sorry,
right.
This
okay.
check is not
there you go.
Good. Number 4 sign, your insurance company is crazy. They offer coverage for werewolves and vampire attacks.
Okay. All right.
But not bunnies.
Not bunnies. We'll do Twilight, but we don't do Monty Python.
That's right.
Okay, all right,
Twilight,
that's good.
We're okay with.
Okay, all right, good.
Maybe, I don't know. Number 3 sign that they're crazy is... They offer coverage in the event the client gets a hole-in-one and has to buy rounds of drinks for the other players at the golf course.
Yeah. Well, you know.
It was a busy day.
It was a busy day and got to buy drinks.
You need to be reimbursed for that.
Do they cover the DUI or just the insurance?
Well, I don't know.
Just the insurance?
That's
okay.
Just
all right. Okay.
Number 2 sign that they are crazy. Your agent is dressed like a clown.
See, that's a true story, right?
I wish.
Oh, that's not a true story?
I would have... much rather had my agent dress
now my
like
quarterback
a clown.
Coach is an insurance agent, so I should ask him if that's real.
Does he dress like a clown?
That would be awesome. That
Does
would be hilarious. I would love
balloons
that.
At kids' birthday parties. And the number 1 sign that your insurance is crazy. They insured Gil.
Oh man.
Sorry, buddy.
That dude is an accident waiting to happen. Oh, man.
On the scaffolding?
Well, on the scaffolding. This is a true story. This is a true story. I took Gil to get an x-ray on his hand one time, and his thumb is split like a cow hoof in the bone.
The bone is?
The bone. It's split like a cow hoof, and the doctor said, how'd you do that? He goes, I don't know. He doesn't even have any memory of it. That's probably because he got hit in the head too many times, but that's a whole other thing. All right.
We're a hard hat.
Wow. Well, let's pray. Let's get going, okay? Heavenly Father, we do just come before you tonight, thanking you and praising you for the opportunity. And Father, we just want to pray that as we dive into your word, as we dive into Luke chapter 4, Father, would you teach us about yourself? Would you teach us who we are in you? Would you teach us more about the spiritual journey that we're on? And Father, may we become a little bit more like you because we're here tonight. Would you just speak to us? It's in your precious and holy name that we pray, and all of God's people said.
Buckle up and hold on. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. And we're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live life to the fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts, and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. At our church, we're not concerned with where you've been, but where you're going. At our church, we believe that the Bible is God's Word. It is real, it is living, it is active. We believe that people who don't go to church anywhere are not the enemy. They are real people who need the perfect love that only God can give. And we believe that God gives this love through, of all people, us. At our church, we do not and we will not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people, but He is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on the cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and we will not candy coat or water down that message, ever. Today, you've chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
Welcome, everybody. It's good to have you. Jake, I switched mics on you. You still don't have me? I think you're messing with me. I think it's you. It's you, it's not me. Guys, thanks for coming. It is Tuesday night, and usually I'm sitting in the balcony because I'm the youth leader. So every now and then, Todd invites me down to share with you guys. Still in the same book of Luke that we've always been in, that we started in October. So tonight you got me, the youth leader, and I can't promise you all my jokes are going to be above board because I'm used to hanging out with 10th graders. So I might have some 10th grade humor for you, but sometimes you just got to go for it, right? You just got to do it. Seriously, you just got to do it. I know every single one of you has crossed that line sometime. But thanks for joining us. I hope you guys feel welcome. My name is Justin. I'm one of the teaching elders here. And we've been working our way through the book of Luke since October. And specifically, in the last 40 days, we've been focused on our prayer life, right? And we've been journeying through a book together, Draw the Circle, a devotional that's just really unlocked a lot of stuff for me and my family. And I hope that it has also unlocked some stuff for you. But tonight, we're just going to keep journeying and kind of remember in the back of your head all of those circles that have been praying, because it's just who you are and it's where you've been the last 40 days. So just recently in our journey, we saw Jesus get up in his hometown church of Nazareth and read from Scripture, a portion found in Isaiah. He fulfilled it. He reads it and it says, "What you've heard today, I have fulfilled." And that kind of upset a few people, right? In fact, it just not only upset them, but they just weren't mildly irritated. They were really annoyed, so much to the point where they grabbed him and they moved him to the side of a cliff, getting ready to throw him off. And then our scripture just says that he was able to just walk right through him. So Jesus did some ninja skills, and I don't know what that looks like, a big angry mob, and he just kind of slips away in the dark. But he's got a black belt, so that's all I know. So this week we see that he travels a little bit. we see that he goes from Nazareth to a town called Capernaum, all right? We're going to kind of look at what he's doing right there in Capernaum. But before we do that, let's pray. Let's silence our cell phones, all right? Let's take a moment and do that. Mine's actually not, so there we go. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight. We just ask that you would bless tonight. We ask that you bless the words that we see here in Luke and the life that you lived. And God, we just ask that instead of us reading ourselves into the Bible, that we let your word read itself into our life and we shape around your word. So God, we just ask that you would bless tonight, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, Luke chapter 4, verse 31 is where we're going to pick it up, all right? So if you haven't already, grab your Bible and go for it. But we're going to pick it up in 31. It says, "Then Jesus went to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, and taught there in the synagogue every Sabbath day. There, too, the people were amazed at his teaching, for he spoke with authority." We're going to stop right there. I know it's only two sentences. But last time we saw Jesus, he was teaching, and he was in his hometown. And right there in his hometown, he's probably just chilling out and maxing, relaxing, all cool, you know, maybe shooting some b-ball outside of the school. Again, 10th grade humor, I'm just saying. Now you're going to sing that all night. But he's there in Nazareth, and he's teaching, and he changes scenery a little bit, right? So he's got to go on this journey. So Capernaum and Nazareth are all located right there in Galilee. So let's see what that looks like there on the map. So we see the dotted line. That's Galilee, and then we see, let me circle it for you, we see Nazareth right there. Nazareth, that's where he was, and then he walks all the way to Capernaum, right in there, right on the edge of the Sea of Galilee, all right? I'm not the best John Madden. John Madden's probably better than that. But so he walks there, and because these towns still exist today, we can actually see a path that he would have taken. So let's look at that. I Google Maps it, because why not? So you see Nazareth, and you got a couple choices. The sky's the limit. You got a few options here. The blue one is the one I probably would have chosen. I don't know what Jesus would have done. But it's about 9 hours, 59 minutes. It's about 10 hours. That's walking, right? That's by sandal. So he goes from Nazareth to Capernaum. All right? So right there, we see that Jesus would have walked upwards of 10 hours to travel from Nazareth to Capernaum. So he's got to move a little bit, right? So while he's there, he makes himself available right there in Capernaum. He teaches in the synagogue every day. He just wasn't living there and teaching on the weekends, but he was there every day. People gathered just to hear him speak. So we got this word synagogue, and let's see what that means, right? Synagogue comes from the Greek word synagogue, which means to gather together, all right? It just means to gather together. Also, something very interesting about this word is that in its earliest usage, it doesn't refer to the building. It doesn't refer to the walls. It refers to the group of people, all right? So this group of people could be anywhere. Like last week, we saw that most likely people just built an extra room on the back of their house, and they had church right there. So rather, it's not really a physical location. Rather, it's a group of people just gathering together and reading scripture and worshiping. See, we have something we share with Jesus right here, but we call it church, don't we? And remember, the church is not these four walls. The church is not just located right here. The church is actually us. In early usage of the word church, it referred to the group of people to gather together. See, Ephesians, Paul writes this, "God has put all things under the authority of Christ and has made him head over all things for the benefit of the church. And the church is his body, not the building, but us. It is made full and complete by Christ who fills all things everywhere with himself." So Jesus is teaching with a group of people. He's not there for the benefit of the building. He's not there for the benefit of the four walls. It has nothing to do with that. But it has everything to do with the people that are right there listening. So we pick it up right there. He's teaching. He's doing exactly what he came to do. He's speaking with authority. Now we see something in our first two verses where people just look at him with amazement. they're shocked and in awe about this command he has over the language. See, Jesus spoke with authority and caught the attention of everyone in the room. See, this word authority sounds powerful. It sounds strong. It sounds respectful, right? It sounds something that you will respect my authority, right? It just demands attention. So this word right here is also translated as another word. So let's jump to Luke 23. Pilate turned to the leading priests and to the crowd and said, "I find nothing wrong with this man." They became insistent, but he is causing riots by his teaching wherever he goes, all over Judea, from Galilee to Jerusalem. "Oh, he's a Galilean?" Pilate asked. When they said that he was, Pilate sent him to Herod Antipas because Galilee was under Herod's jurisdiction, and Herod happened to be in Jerusalem at the time. So our word authority that we just read at the beginning in chapter 4 is translated jurisdiction right here in chapter 23. It's the same word. It carries the same references. See, Herod, in our reference right here, in our example, Herod is the ruler over Galilee at this time. His strength and power was reflected in that region, right? He set up a kingdom and he was tasked with governing over this area. So the people, including Jesus, would have been under Herod's rule. They would have had to follow whatever he suggested or required. See, our police and our emergency responders have jurisdiction here in the city of Greeley, right? Right? They can still do their work outside of the city of Greeley, but they have jurisdiction here inside. They have more authority here. And some of my friends, they say it's less paperwork if they actually do their job inside the city limits than outside. So jurisdiction is kind of cool there too. So the same goes for Jesus's commands, right? Over the scripture, he has the same authority. He has the same jurisdiction. He spoke like he owned the very words that he was reading out of scripture. It's because he did, right? He did own these words. And in fact, he not only owned them, but he was them. Right? He was the Word made flesh. In John chapter 1, you see this. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was God, and the Word was with God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. See, the Word was God, and everything was created through him. Jesus is the Word made flesh. The scripture, God's word, put on human skin and came down for us, right? To live amongst us. We're going to see a few examples of Jesus' authority tonight. The first example that we saw that kind of ties to this one, we saw last week. There's more than just three, but tonight we're just going to see three, right? So the first one we saw last week, like I said, and it was, in fact, Jesus' words carry the authority of the Creator. He's standing there in Nazareth, and he teaches with authority. So how can he get it wrong when he is the Word? He is the author and knows the exact intent of the Scripture. We don't have to write the author and ask him, "What do you mean?" We don't have to do that. We don't have to look up YouTube videos of interviews. "What do you mean when you said this?" We get it straight from his mouth. Jesus knows the exact intent. That's why he speaks with authority. So Jesus not only speaks with authority because he was there, but he was there when these words were written, right? So back to Luke chapter 4, we pick it up in verse 33. "Once when he was in the synagogue, a man possessed by a demon, an evil spirit, cried out, shouting, 'Go away! Why are you interfering with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus reprimanded him, 'Be quiet, come out of the man,' he ordered. At that, the demon threw the man on the floor as the crowd watched. Then it came out of him without hurting him further. Amazed, the people exclaimed, 'What authority and power this man's words possess! Even evil spirits obey him, and they flee at his command.' The news about Jesus spread through every village in the entire region." So there's story number two. Right there. Jesus has a tangle with some demons. See, when we see this demon cause a commotion, let's point out the place setting that it happens at. It happens right there in church, right there in the synagogue. Jesus is teaching. He's reading the scripture. And then a man stands up and causes a commotion. Now, I can't imagine what this would have looked like in the middle of church when somebody just stands up and causes this big scene, because I know I've never seen that here at Waypoints. That's never happened. We've never even come close to anything like that, right? No, I mean, it's crazy what a sight that would have been. But that's where it happens. It happens right there in church. Jesus is teaching, and it's just business as usual, and someone interrupts Jesus. See, as Jesus is working for God, advancing the kingdom word by word in Scripture, the enemy doesn't sit still, does he? Absolutely not. Can't stand it. He has to do something. Satan is boiling mad after the 40 days in the desert, right? He just fought off all those temptations. And Jesus goes to synagogue and just starts teaching. Well, I can't get him there, so I'm going to get him right when he's in the hot seat, when he's teaching. So that's exactly what Satan is doing. He attacks, not when it's convenient for us, but when it's convenient for him, right? So Jesus is advancing and pushing the kingdom of heaven right through the darkness, cutting through the death and making room for life. And that's the moment when Satan says, go. Let's see if we can throw him off. All through the life of Jesus, he battles with demons, disease, death, defeat, darkness, deceit, all of it. Takes it on. He goes right to battle. Those 40 days in the wilderness were preparing Jesus to be battle ready, right? Just like our 40 days of prayer. We've been talking about being battle ready. Ready for something that God's moving us to. Just ready to continue the kingdom of heaven. See, Satan wants nothing more than to challenge Jesus' mission. That's exactly what he does. Satan sends a demon-possessed man to challenge Jesus. Now, remember when we walked through Whole and Holy, that we talked about what a prayer life looks like, right? Conversations with God. What does our role look like? What does God's role look like? And we took on different prayers, and we just walked our way through this. And in fact, if you want to, those messages are still up on the website. I encourage you guys to go back to our website and check out Whole and Holy. It was a 12-week, 13-week, something like that series. So it's pretty awesome. Just go for it. But I want to recap something that we talked about in that series. Simply for the fact that if we truly understand what we're living with in this world, then that makes God's glory all the more greater, right? And that one little thing that I want to talk about is demonic forces, the spiritual battle that is all over, that is around you and I every day. And sometimes we don't see it. And I think that when we don't see it, we have a tendency to just ignore it, right? Oh, it's God's got that. God's got that. But sometimes we do see it. See, we can fall into two camps here. Some of us may not believe in his existence, that is Satan. It's not uncommon to meet believers who think that Satan does not exist. It's just a story. Jesus was real, but Satan's not real, right? Jesus did come and save me, but Satan, he's just, they didn't have science, and they just explained it with the boogeyman, right? So we as believers have a very real enemy who is very good at what he does. He's very good. Now remember, he's not omnipresent. He's not everywhere. He doesn't hear everything. He's not all-knowing. He's a good note taker. He does not share the same characteristics of God because he is part of creation as well. 1 Peter says this, "Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are." Satan is very real. The other side of the coin that I think we as believers can get tripped up by is maybe focusing on Satan and his demons a little too much, right? That's when we always look for the devil behind every bush, blaming every bad thing on Satan, giving him too much credit, right? Patting him on the back a little too much. And in turn, we become maybe a little too enamored by him. Like, oh, that was Satan. I know the work of Satan. And then all of a sudden, we're focused more on the work of Satan than the work of God, right? And these are just two camps that I think we can fall on. The answer is somewhere in the middle. We have an enemy. Be aware, like Peter said right there, stay alert. Satan is real. But don't forget, God has your back. See, we can either deny Satan's existence or we can just focus too much on him. There is a real spiritual world that is happening around us, and we can be distracted by the physicality that our world offers, right? We like to hold and touch and feel stuff and smell it and taste it, and then we know that it's real, right? But if we can't do any of that, we just write it off as nonsense, right? I can't feel it, I can't hold it, so it's nonsense. It just doesn't exist. So Satan wants nothing more than to disrupt Jesus' ministry. So let's just continue this open conversation. This man is possessed, right? We see that. Our scripture tells us he's a demonic possessed man. And possession shows ownership and control over something else. So right now, Satan has ownership and control over this man through a demon. So let's just dispel a myth. Believers of Christ cannot fall under this ownership or control. We cannot be possessed. 1 John says this, "But you belong to God, my dear children. You have already won a victory over those people because the Spirit who lives in you is greater than the Spirit who lives in the world." Where the Holy Spirit is, nothing else can live there. Where the light is, darkness cannot dwell, right? So this man, he's under ownership right now. See, something that is also very real is demonic oppression. Now, oppression is when we are exposed to unjust treatment or distress, right? This can look like many different things. It can come in the form of lie after lie through demonic influences to us as believers, telling us things like we're no good. How can we call ourselves a Christian with behaviors like that? I thought God set you free from that. Lie after lie just kind of build up, and we give power over to these lies. And then we're left with nothing but despair and loneliness. Sin and the constant lies from the demonic can lead us to a place of that. This feeling of being burdened, this depression. So meanwhile, back at the ranch, right, Jesus is teaching. He's teaching, and then a demonic man stands up. And he speaks with such authority that people are amazed. And in fact, the spirits leave. Jesus simply just says leave, and that spirit had to go with it, right? It just had to, it was one word, get out of here, and the spirit left. Nothing crazy, you know, it wasn't like Rosemary's Baby or The Exorcist with weird stuff. It just was simple, leave, and it was done. Nothing weird. See, Jesus not only has authority when he's teaching, but he has authority over unclean spirits. So let's go to the next battle. Pick it up in verse 38. After leaving the synagogue that day, Jesus went to Simon's home where he found Simon's mother-in-law very sick with a high fever. "Please heal her," everyone begged. Standing at her bedside, he rebuked the fever and it left her. And she got up at once and prepared a meal for them. As the sun went down that evening, people throughout the village brought sick family members to Jesus. No matter what their diseases were, the touch of his hand healed everyone. Many were possessed by demons, and the demons came out at his command shouting, "You are the Son of God." But because they knew he was the Messiah, he rebuked them and refused to let them speak. So Jesus just continues his day, right? It's no big deal for Jesus. He woke up, taught a little bit, cast out a demon. He ate some lunch, went over to his friend's house, right, where he found his friend's mother-in-law was sick. So he heals her, and then she makes him some dinner. I don't know what that looks like. Hey, thanks for, the fever's gone. I'm going to cook you some food, right? So it's just another day. It's just another day for Jesus. And so we see him here, right here in Simon's house now. Simon is also Peter. We know him as Peter throughout Scripture. Simon Peter is the one that Jesus said, "I will build my house, my church upon you." This is the same guy. So Simon, we have a tendency to think that through, you know, some parts of our churchdom, our church in America, likes to say that Peter was not married, but I don't know how you just sign up for a mother-in-law without going and getting a wife, right? You don't just go, I'm going to get a mother-in-law today. I mean, there's a step missing. So Peter is married, and in fact, church scholars and historians, early church historians, say that she was just as sold out as Peter was. Right there with him in the church, right there with him on missions trips. So Peter has a wife, and his mother-in-law lives with him. Also very strange, but, you know, it worked for them. So in this small house, his mother-in-law is sick. And he invites Jesus into his house, and Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law. This woman has a high fever, and with just simple words, he rebukes, reprimands, puts the fever in his place, and the fever leaves. He pushed the fever under the judgment and authority of God the Father, and the fever has to obey it. So the fever goes. So once again, Jesus is showing his authority. Not only through demonic possession, but through death and disease, those two things also obey Jesus' command. Jesus, over the last few weeks, has really been putting something out for us, specifically going back to last week. And right there in your program, we're going to lay out the three battles, just to recap them again. The first battle we saw last week, that's where he waged war against religion. He reads Scripture, and he challenges the very thought of the day. This way of life is for everyone. The thing that Jesus came to bring into this world was for everyone. See, you don't have to be born of a certain family to be part of God's family. And that's what Jesus was getting to. That he called out his teachers, his elders, and said they loved their religion more than they loved their God. You hold your religion and your rules a little too high. God should have that place. And the strict religious bunch there in Nazareth didn't accept that really well, did they? No, they asked him to leave. They laid hands on him and escorted him out of town. They got him out of there. So what does he do? Does he go back into that town? No. He lands in a place where there's just normal everyday people. He goes from the strict religious area of Nazareth to Capernaum, which is just blue-collar, everyday workers. People that can accept the message that Jesus can bring. That they don't have the rules that get in the way. So Jesus lands right there. Just average, everyday people like you and I. People that work. People that love God. Right? So he goes to where people accept him, and he continues to teach. So Jesus surrounds himself with people that are not religious. And in fact, the first interaction that we see of him in Galilee is with a man who is demon-possessed. How do you think that man that is demon-possessed would have been accepted at the church of Nazareth? Maybe a little different, right? They probably wouldn't have liked it. But here in Capernaum, he's sitting right there amongst them. He's sitting right there. And Jesus sets him free. So which leads us to the second battle. Jesus picks a fight with demonic rule. He says a word and the demons flee from him. It takes nothing for him to convince the demon to leave because the demon recognizes who Jesus is. See, the demon shouts that Jesus is the Son of God. We see that, and then we saw later that after the town saw him heal people and set them free from demonic possession, that they brought more people to him. And that all of these demons said that he was the Son of God, but Jesus says what? He says, no, leave. He tells them to shut up. Why does he tell a demon to shut up? Because a demon proclaiming that that's Jesus, the Son of God, Jesus can do that himself, right? Jesus can speak for himself. Our God can speak for himself. He doesn't need Satan to do it for him. So he sends him packing. And as a quiet house with a newfound friend, he heals someone. And that leads us to the third battle. where he picks with death and disease. At the very word, he heals a woman who is fighting a fever, and the body responds. Each one of these battles comes, and Jesus proves another aspect of his character. He proves another layer of his authority. Each one of these battles that was waged proves that he is the Son of God. Because if you remember the portion in Scripture that he read from Isaiah, let's just recap it. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring the good news to the poor. He did that, right? He speaks with authority. And then he has sent me to proclaim the captives will be released, that the blind will see. He heals people, right? He did that battle. That's battle number three. That the oppressed will be set free. Oh, wait, that's battle number two. So he does everything he said he was going to do. Jesus is just following the plan. See, our God is very poetic. And sometimes in our scripture, it lays it out in a very poetic way. Our God mimics this. See, Jesus reads these words laid out in Luke, and then the next three things that he does fulfill that one verse that he read. He fulfills each one of those. Let's pick it up, wrap up chapter 4. Verse 42 says this, early in the next morning, Jesus went out to an isolated place. The crowd searched everywhere for him, and when they finally found him, they begged him not to leave them. But he replied, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God in other towns too, because that is why I was sent. So he continued to travel around, preaching in synagogues throughout Judea. He went about with his business as usual. He continued on with the mission. And friends, we saw Jesus walk in authority. God created this earth and humanity, and his authority is above all of it. You and I are under that authority. This evidence, because we see that he gives the command and creation responds. So not only does he create through his words, but he can also redeem through his words. It's kind of like a car, right? We buy a new car, whatever it is, Ford, Chevy, I don't know what you guys like, Dodge, I don't know. But it's got that make stamped all over it, right? Every single piece has Ford on it, right? An OEM part. It's got a part number that's traced, and it comes from the Ford plant. So you buy this car. So would you take it to like a Volkswagen or a Subaru dealership for maintenance? And let's put some Subaru parts on this thing? No. No, you'd take it to the Ford dealership where they have Ford parts to put on the Ford, right? So just like Ford has jurisdiction in Fords, Jesus has jurisdiction here with creation. So why not bring things under his authority? Why not continue to circle those things in prayer, continuing to bring them under his authority? Why take it to the Subaru dealership and just have some parts slapped on it just to make it better? It'll get by, but is it right? No. We'll worry about it later, right? I'll fix that later. See, Jesus went through the 40 days being tempted and tried. He was questioned. All for what? For this battle that he just stepped into. He had to be tempted and tried, and he had to take the time to prepare for battle because he knew that once he was in the middle of battle, that's the wrong time to prepare, right? That is the wrong time to learn how to swing a sword is when your enemy is charging at you. Like, oh, I think this is how you do it. I don't know. So he took those 40 days, and in fact, he didn't take the next 40 off. He jumped right in. He didn't go, well, I need to take a break before I get my hands dirty. He didn't do that. In church, we find ourselves in the last 10 days or so in our 40 days. It's coming to an end. And we should expect nothing different for our life. We should expect nothing different. We've been circling and circling things in prayer. Individually, as a family, as a community, we have been circling things in prayer, bringing it under the authority of Jesus. But what happens when these 40 days are over? Do we take the next 40 off? No. No, you don't take the next 40 off. You don't just sit back and take the next few months and relax. You got to get up. You got to decide to be battle ready, and that's exactly what you're going to do. To be battle ready means that we have to be ready for a battle, right? It makes no sense to prepare over and over for something and then just because nothing happens, we can take time off. See, comfortability and complacency actually makes you weaker. Remember, it's trials that makes us stronger. It's the battle that makes us stronger. Jesus does not take time off. He takes his authority that has been tested and he uses it. See, Jesus does not abuse his authority. But he uses the right exact measure at the right time. When a demon-possessed man comes in, he uses the authority right there. When he needs to heal somebody, he uses the authority. He doesn't just wave his hand over all of creation and say, be fixed, right? He uses the right measure at the right time. See, guys, we can become so relaxed and comfortable, right? That we just lay down our swords. Oh, the battle's not here yet. I'm ready, but these are getting heavy, so I'm just going to put them down, right? I'm just going to take some time off. See, and it's times like that, that we have nothing to fight for, that's when we actually fall asleep. When we have nothing to do, we fall asleep. But don't just find any fight. You got to find the right fight. You got to find the fight that God has placed in your life. Find the passion that keeps you up at night or the things that break your heart, right? Circle it in prayer and then take a step. Don't wait for God to give you the entire plan. I know you and I know me, right? Don't wait for the entire plan. Just go for it. God will take care of it. If he's given you the desire, then he's got a plan, right? Don't put expectations on that plan, but just follow God's plan. Get your sword and shield and go to work. See, we're joined with Jesus in this same authority that we saw him carry out. So not only is creation and us under it, but we share in this authority. God does not grant some people more authority than others, right? It takes a church. Now remember, it's not the building. It doesn't take the building to do God's work. It takes the people inside the building, you and I, to do it. Colossians chapter 2 says this, "You were dead because of your sins, and because your sinful nature was not yet cut away, then God made you alive with Christ, for he forgave all of your sins. He canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. In this way, he disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. He triumphed over Satan, and he canceled any right Satan has to us. We share in this authority. So in the next 40 days, we got to keep going. We have this tendency to think that the kingdom of heaven is just here, right? That when it comes in, it fills an empty void. But guys, it doesn't happen like that. Like the old saying goes, there's no God-shaped hole that's perfectly right there that God just can kind of fill. Something is in that place, right? Something has taken that place. It's not an empty void. The kingdom of heaven, when it advances, it is pushing another kingdom aside, making way for itself. And anytime two kingdoms occupy the same space, it's going to be violent, right? We've seen that movie. We've read the history books. Anytime a kingdom comes against another kingdom, it's not rainbows and butterflies. It's going to be maybe a little violent. So I want to leave you with a few thoughts. The battle is up to you. The church, the people, you guys, not the building. It's up to you. It's up to us. Some of us have been following long enough and it's time to lead. In fact, some of us have been holding on to the past and it's time to let go, because if you're holding on to the past, how can you pick up to fight for the future? Some of us have been fighting battles in the name of God, but that doesn't mean it's the right battle. Some of us have been praying over and over and it's time to take action. Instead of making rules and making the expectations for God's plan, let God set those rules and expectations for his plan. See, Jesus came to spread the gospel to everyone. Heal the sick, free the oppressed, and you can trust that. And that's exactly what he did right here tonight, and that's exactly what he wants to continue to do in your life. And ultimately, that's what he's inviting you to do for your neighborhood, for your coworker, for your family, for anybody you meet. He wants to walk the kingdom of heaven out in your life and through your life. Give God the glory. He wants to do it all through us, his people, not the building, but us. See, the kingdom of heaven only advances when you and I accept the invitation and are willing to go where God guides us. So tonight we're going to do something a little different. We have a group of high schoolers from Cornerstone Christian Academy that are going to share something with us tonight. In partnership with In Motion Ministries, they're kind of on their mission week, and they want to come and serve us tonight. So I'm going to invite them up, and they have something to share with us. All right?
Oh, never.
Thank you, guys. That was that actually fit pretty well, pretty awesome. And there was no planning that out. That's just how God works. When the phone calls come in, and you know, and things like this get planned, we don't know where we're going to be at in our scripture. But thank you, guys, for that, guys. Jesus' authority can take on everything, every single one of those that was displayed here tonight. And he can take on much, much more. So in our transition, we're going to sing some songs. So the worship team's going to come up. I'm going to ask everybody to stand up. All right, so go ahead and stand up while the worship team's coming up. Point a few things around the room for you. The altar is over here on this side of the room. If you guys want to lay something down at the altar or pray at the altar, there's a couple pillows. Bring stuff to the altar. In fact, if God has impressed upon your heart to pray, I want you to just to pray. Over here on this side, we have communion. If you have a relationship with Jesus, then that's here for you to reflect on that sacrifice. Balcony, you have an altar and communion up there as well. If you don't know what to pray for, you've been praying and you just run out of the words, there's going to be people in this back hall that are going to be more than willing to pray for you and with you. So please, take advantage of that. Tonight we're just going to continue to worship, continue to lay those things down, continue to become battle ready, because the fight's not over. Guys, the fight is just beginning. This Friday, we're going to have an evening of prayer and worship, where we're going to have a circle. We're going to bring some more stuff. So bring yourself, bring your prayer list. And we're going to cap it off with some more prayer and worship. So let's pray tonight. Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight. We just ask that you would bless. God, we just ask that you would take these songs Lord, we don't sing them for our benefit. Sometimes the words get a little redundant and we just keep singing out of habit. But God, we just pray for a newness tonight. May these words be new on our lips. So God, we just ask that you take them because they're for you. And it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.